Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. We thank our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for another Bible Preach session, Friday evening, 7 p.m., all the way from Sydney, Australia. To those who are with us here at this holy church and those who are watching us through live streaming, we pray that you're always in good health and in good spirit in Jesus' mighty name. And I want to hear an amen.
Amen.
Amen to that. If I could ask everyone to stand for the Lord's Prayer, please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgave our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Psalm 71. In you, O Lord, I put my trust. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness and cause me to escape. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be my strong refuge to which I may resort continually. You have given the commandment to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Deliver me, O my God, out of the hand of the wicked, out of the hand of the unrighteous and cruel men. For you are my hope, O Lord God. You are my trust from my youth. By you I have been upheld from birth. You are he who took me out of my mother's womb. My praise shall be continually of you. I have become as a wonder to many, but you are my strong refuge. Let my mouth be filled with your praise and with your glory all the day. Do not cast me off in the time of old age. Do not forsake me for when my strength fails. For my enemies speak against me, and those who lie in wait for my life take counsel together, saying, God has forsaken him. Pursue and take him, for there is none to deliver him. O God, do not be far from me. O my God, make haste to help me. Let them be confounded and consumed who are adversaries of my life. Let them be covered with reproach and dishonor who seek my hurt. But I will hope continually and will praise you yet more and more. My mouth shall tell of your righteousness and your salvation all the day, for I do not know their limits. I will go in the strength of the Lord God. I will make mention of your righteousness, of yours only. O God, you have taught me from my youth, and to this day I declare your wondrous works. Now also when I am old and gray-headed, O God, do not forsake me until I declare your strength to this generation, your power to everyone who is to come. Also your righteousness, O God, is very high. You who have done great things, O God, who is like you? You who have shown me great and severe troubles shall revive me again and bring me up again from the depths of the earth. You shall increase my greatness and comfort me on every side. Also with the lute I will praise you and your faithfulness, O my God. To you I will sing with the harp, O Holy One of Israel. My lips shall greatly rejoice when I sing to you, and my soul, which you have redeemed. My tongue also shall talk to your righteousness, of your righteousness, all the day long. For they are confounded, for they are brought to shame, who seek my hurt. And all glory be to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Well, a very good evening to everyone. How are we? Are we good? Can't hear you. Can't hear you. Come on, you can do better. On the count of three. One, two, three. Yeah, not bad. All right, thanks very much for coming. My name is Bishop Murray. I'm single and available. I'm hot, you're not. Thank you, see you later. I miss you guys. We just came back from Melbourne, and we thank the Lord Jesus for everything. It was a very blessed trip. There was a lot of people that came on those 2 days there where we held Bible preach, Wednesday and Thursday of last week. Was an Assyrian Wednesday and English Thursday. The church was packed, and from all walks of life came, and all nationalities, which was absolutely amazing. I had a couple of people from, I think it was Eritrea, which is near Sudan, Africa. Beautiful, absolutely magnificent. It's wonderful, you know, when you see all the colors coming together to hear the word of the Lord. This is the beauty of Christ, where all nations and all nationalities and all languages come together. All the colors come together. It's a beautiful portrait. When all colors are mixed, you come up with an absolutely magnificent piece of art. And the greatest artist of all is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Michelangelo, you can eat your heart out, my dear friend. You are nowhere near what Jesus can do in a blink of an eye, or even before the blink of an eye. And Jesus said, "Let there be," and there was. With his word, created everything. God the Father created everything by God the Son, Jesus Christ, the Logos. The Logos. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This Word created everything and everyone on the face of this planet and the next life as well. Jesus Christ is the center of everything, is the center of existence. All right, any new faces for the first time? Show of hands, welcome. My dear friend, and welcome over there. Thank you very much. You are wonderful. So how are we? I asked that, didn't I? Oops, that's not a good sign. It's called old age. All right. This evening, I thought we're going to have a small break from the book of Revelation. I don't know. Every now and then, I did mention before that we're going to have just a small break. Just, you know, to walk away a little bit from the end times and what's going to happen, what's happening, and there's nuclear wars coming and nuclear rockets, and the whole world is going to be destroyed. That's kind of depressing in a way. So I thought we change gear today, and we're going to go to the Epistle of St. Paul to the Ephesians, and we're going to read from chapter 5, verses 15 to 19. Epistle of St. Paul to the Ephesians, chapter 5, verses 15 to 19. Here we go. "See then that you walk circumspectly," or other words, carefully. "See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. And all glory be to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, forever and ever. Amen." Every time St. Paul talks, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we need to pay attention, because his teachings and his epistles are absolutely profound and very deep in theology. And there's so much depth in what St. Paul says. He is one of the great, if not the greatest theologian the world has and will ever see. An absolute theologian, teachings to the depth of theology, my beloved. But we're going to sort of breeze through it. St. Paul, his epistles to the Ephesians. In this chapter 5, He is trying, or he is actually revealing to us the characteristic of those who are wise. What is the characteristic of a wise man, a wise person? In these verses, St. Paul is revealing the characteristic of a wise person, my beloveds. But before we come to the wise, we need to see who is the fool. Before we come to the wise, we need to see who is the fool. A fool person is the one who ignores his end, the ending of his life on earth. The one who does not care about his eternity. Any human that cares not about their end on earth, about their eternal life, they are considered as fools. They are considered as fools. Also, fools are referred, as is mentioned by St. Paul in these verses, as the unwise as well. You can say ignorant, unwise, fool. So the fool is also referred to be unwise. Because the Holy Gospel teaches us, and specifically in Matthew 25:13, where the Lord Jesus is speaking here, the Lord Jesus himself, in Matthew 25:13, where he says, "Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming." You need to be wise. Why? Because you do not know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. In this particular verse, the Lord Jesus is sending a very important message to all of us. You see, the day and the hour, the Lord says, you do not know. Why? Because the day and the hour is only known in the thought of God. Every single one of us has a day and has an hour to be born and to depart at the same time. That departure, the Lord says, you don't know the day, neither the day nor the hour, because it is only known by God. Since you don't know the day nor the hour of your departure from this world, you need, therefore, to be wise, not a fool or unwise person. Job, who has heard of Job? Who has read the book of Job? Not many. Wonderful. You better start reading the book of Job. Now, in Job 14:5, by the way, the book of Job teaches you on how to live a life of perseverance. If you want to learn on how to persevere with difficulties, on how to persevere with persecutions, on how to persevere with dark tunnels in your life, how to learn on how to persevere with heavy burdens, read the book of Job. It teaches you perfectly on how to be a persevering person. Now, in Job 14:5, he says, since his days are determined, the number of his months is with you. You have appointed his limit so that he cannot pass. Meaning, God has determined how long you will live on the face of this earth. Someone will come along and say, Bishop, you know what? Technology now is advanced and the medical field is so advanced that we are, as doctors, we are giving a new life to so many people. We've just done a kidney transplant. We've put a battery and we made the heart pump for many more days and months and years. But my dear friend, even that was in the mind of God before creating anything. God knew a time will come where technology will advance, knowledge, human knowledge will increase, and they will start doing certain operations that was not possible previously or prior to that era. And they will think they are giving an extra time for this human being. Even that extra time was included by God before creating anyone or anything. So you lived an extra 20 years, God had already planned it. For there is nothing a surprise to God. You cannot add or subtract to the time frame God has given you. Cannot. When the time comes, the Lord Jesus sends his angel. By the way, angels come to take your spirit. It's not the moment now, but if you're a good boy or a good girl, the Lord will give you a pre-warning. Like saints, some saints knew because it was revealed by the Lord. But when the time comes, the Lord sends his angel. And the enemy sends his angel, or his foul spirit. And they'll both come fighting for your spirit and my spirit. You belong to Jesus Christ. The angel of light will receive it. And then he will check your record. And if you belong to the Lord Jesus, the light of Christ will encircle you. That's why the Lord Jesus said, if you believe in me, you will not see death. The Lord Jesus did not say you will not taste death. He said you will not see death, because everyone will taste death. But the Lord said you will not see death. Then what is death? Darkness. If light is life, then darkness is death. The Lord says, when you belong to me, the moment the spirit leaves the body, my light, I am the light of the world. John 12:8, the Lord Jesus says, I am the light of the world. He says, my light will encircle you and you will not see darkness, i.e. death. You will be carried in my light till you come face to face with me, the Creator, God, revealed in the flesh, but in a glorified body. You will see God as a human. His name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Oh my goodness. When you see this man, you will not ever ask for anyone else or any other God. This man suffices and beyond. This man blows your mind away. This man fills you, enriches you, and make you wonder what kind of a man this man is. So, our days are determined by God. No one can pass those days which God has placed. I can assure you, God is perfect in every aspect, in every way, form, or shape. When the time comes to the dot, the angel will come. And when the Lord calls that spirit, there is no power, neither in heaven, nor on earth, nor beneath it, to stop that moment that God had appointed from the very beginning. I have to go. I have to go. Nothing can stop the spirit from leaving this body when Jesus calls that spirit to him. And if you are extra special, he may send his mother with the angel, accompanied by the angels. And if you are extra, extra special, he may come himself to welcome you home. But if you're okay, yeah, the angel will do. Believe me, I wish I could see an angel. It's plenty. They are gorgeous creatures, these angels. Absolutely gorgeous and frightening as well. No, not really. They're gorgeous. They're here to serve us anyway, so you cannot be afraid of an angel. They are here to serve us. Radio. Therefore, since St. Paul is saying, choose on how to walk carefully, because don't be a fool, but be wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. So what is he saying? He says the best thing, he's telling us all, the best thing to do is redeem the time because the days are evil. Now my question to all of us, when we just look around for just a moment, what we see around us that has been happening and is happening, I don't think is anything short of an evil era and an evil time, isn't it? Isn't it? Yes? Would you agree? I want to hear you.
Yes.
Well, the times are evil. Therefore, he says the best thing is redeem. Redeem the time because the days are evil. And honestly, what is happening in the world as we speak is absolute sickening to the core. I just cannot fathom to what kind of a level a human being has reached. A very low level, I must say. Morally speaking, it is an absolute bankrupt generation. Morally speaking, it is an absolute bankrupt generation. There is no more morals, ethics, values, principles. It is whatever. Whatever you feel like, do. Whatever you feel like, just say. And however you feel like looking, go for it. You want to change yourself? Feel free. You want to dress, undress? Feel free. You want to be it, him, she, or in between? Feel free. It is an absolutely corrupt generation and morally bankrupt. And the most... better continue. We are looking at leadership on a secular level and the religious level as well. Childish, absolute childish behavior. No more wise. There's plenty of fools, very little wise people left. Plenty of fools. Oh, here we go. So he's telling us, St. Paul, the best thing to do is to redeem the time, for the days are evil. Because you do not know what will happen next. Why you do not know what will happen next? Because the days are evil. Because the days are evil. That's why we just wonder a lot of times, what is awaiting me? What is going to happen tomorrow? I'm so worried. I'm so concerned. I'm so confused. I don't know what to do anymore. I don't know, shall I take this job? Shall I marry this man or this woman? Shall I do this business? Shall I stay at home? Do I take my children to school? Or do I take him out of the school because of the corrupt educational system? What do I do? The days are evil. You know, when everything goes evil, it's like a vicious ocean gone wild. So the waves will come and strike you left, right, and center, and you tend to lose your sense of direction so many times because you've been bashed, kicked, punched all over. Because we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. The days are evil. So the question is now, how do I redeem the time? And what is redemption? How do I redeem the time? And what is redemption? What is redemption? Basically, redemption is something that I have lost and now I have regained. It's something that I have lost and now that I have regained. When I regain what was lost, that is called redemption. And this is exactly why Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, is called the Redeemer. Why? Because all of us were lost, and Christ came and found us one more time. And when He brought us back, what did He do? He redeemed what was lost. That's why He is called the Redeemer. That's why He's called the Redeemer. But there's a problem. Once time goes by, that time will never come back. Once the clock ticks, that second went by, you cannot bring it back. You see, we are sitting in the church. From the time we started, it's been, oh my goodness, 26 minutes. I thought it was 26 seconds. 26 minutes since we started. Now, thanks to this good-looking bishop, we are 26 minutes older. And 26 minutes of our life has gone by that cannot be brought back again. But you'll say, Bishop, I didn't go anywhere. I'm in the church. I remained seated in my chair. I did not move. So how come this time went by? Because, my beloved child, humanity, or the human being, moves in the time, not in the place. We move in time, not in place. So we could be absolute stagnant in our place, but time is what we move in. Therefore, what governs us is time. And the time that goes by can never be brought back. So what do I do? How can I redeem the time? Because the days are evil, Saint Paul says. I can't bring that time back. So what shall I do? One thing. You surrender your life to Christ. It is the only way to redeem the time lost is by surrendering your life to Christ and Christ only. When we surrender our life to the Lord Jesus, what happens? The Lord Jesus takes us and places us above the time. He takes us and places us all above the time. And when He takes us and put us above the time, there is no time. Therefore, time is not important anymore. It does not exist. So what is above the time? Eternity. Eternal life. Eternal life is a place where time ceases, does not exist. As someone put it this way, he said, time is a distraction to eternity. Time is a what? Distraction to eternity. For God to take the human race out of the eternal realm, He had to create time. For time took us out of the eternal realm. The moment time ceases, you are in the eternal realm. And in the eternal realm, you don't have choices. You don't have options. You don't have a second chance. You only have once and once forever. And God knew we will not last one split second in the eternal realm. Out of grace and mercy, He put us in a realm that is governed by time. Therefore, time is to do with the temporal life. Faith is to do with the eternal life. I'll say it again. Therefore, time is to do with the temporal life. Faith is to do with the eternal life. I'm talking to you in a very simple terminology. St. Paul talks very deep, right? So now, everything that is governed by time is temporal. Everything that is governed by time is temporal. The tree is temporal. The fish is temporal. The bird is temporal. The plant is temporal. The human is temporal. Everything that is governed by time will end. Will end. Now, we are living in a realm that is governed by time. But the Lord Jesus says, when you surrender your life to me, when you give it to me, I, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I am the creator of time. I am the creator of time. Then when you give your life to me, I will take you into a place where time does not exist. And that's where I am, you will be with me. Where I am, there is no time, because I am the creator of time. Therefore, I am above the time. St. Paul says, redeem the time, for the days are evil. Literally, he is saying, stop wasting more time since you've already wasted enough. Stop wasting more time trying to fix the world. Stop wasting enough time trying to fix the past that you can't go back to or bring back. You see, we sit and cry over things that are already gone. I can't bring them back. I cannot. So what are we doing? I am wasting more time, valuable time, trying to fix something that is gone. Oh, why did I do this? Why did I say that? Why didn't I do that? Why didn't I go? Why didn't I listen? Too late. Get alive, get up, dust it off, and look forward to a brighter future. Now please pay attention. I beg you, by the grace of God, the Almighty God, pay attention. Everything we do, everything we say, everything we think of outside of Jesus Christ is evil. I'll say it again. Everything we do, everything we say, everything we think of outside of Jesus Christ is evil. Everything you do in this world outside of Jesus Christ is evil. You know why? Because this world, the Holy Bible is telling us, not me, it is God himself. He said, this world is placed, not Satan is just the ruler. No, this world is placed in the bosom of Satan, meaning Satan has encircled this world in his bosom. He's grabbed it. It's his. It's his. Now, don't be shocked and say, why is this happening in the world? Because the one who is actually ruling over this world is the evil one. What are you going to expect from the evil one? Nothing but evil. Please wake up. We have been deceived by the temptation of the world. We have been deceived by the lust of the world. We have been deceived by the rainbow colors, which rainbow was the sign of God. Yet shame on such generation to abuse this rainbow. Shame on you. All these colors, holidays, clubbing, dancing, eating, drinking, fashion, Botox, drugs, alcohol, gambling, and floating around in this world, it is all evil, evil, evil. There is no such thing as I was having fun. We need to define what is fun. Don't be a fool, be wise. Do not just throw words left, right, and center without thinking about what you're saying, without focusing on what you're saying, without weighing what you are about to say. You need to be wise. You need to be wise. Time is to do with the temporal life. Faith is to do with the eternal life. Before I continue, is it hot in the church? No? Must be me then. Right. All right. You see, in the midst of seriousness, it doesn't hurt to say, to be a little bit humorous. There you go. Now, how can I elevate myself above the time? When I turn to the crucified Messiah, how can I elevate myself and be above the time when I turn to the crucified Jesus Christ of Nazareth? I'll give you this from the Holy Bible. The two thieves that were crucified on either side of the Lord Jesus. How come one of them was saved, the other was lost? What happened to this man who was saved by the Lord Jesus? What happened? Four things. You know, this guy was 100% going to hell. 100. No chance. He done everything wrong under the sun. He was a murderer. He was a thief. He was everything. Everything bad you could think of. And he's crucified now. He's nailed on the cross, meaning he can't go back and try to change his lifestyle. Too late, he is about to die. Biologically, physically, he's about to die. The last seconds of his life are ticking away right before his very eyes while he is hanged on the cross. But four things saved this man. Four things made this murderer, this thief, this bad citizen to redeem the time, for the days are evil. Four things. Number one, when he heard the Lord Jesus saying, "Father, forgive them." Number two, fear of the Lord. Number three, confession of guilt. Number four, confession of the perfection of Christ. Number one, when he heard the Lord Jesus saying, "Father, forgive them." Now, I'm sure the word would have gone around and this man would have heard, there is this great teacher and preacher and great prophet and great man of God that has come and wiped the entire Israelite nation, you know, with his absolute, you know, powerful teaching and wondrous doings. So he's heard that he is claiming to be the Son of God, meaning he's coming from above. So he would have wondered, who is his God? Who is his father? Where is his father? So when he heard the Lord on the cross saying, "Father, forgive them," he looked in the crowd. Because normally, when you call someone's name, you definitely look at them, don't you? You know? When you say, "Hi, God." When you say, "George," you look at George. You don't look at someone else, you look at George. So when he said, "Father," this thief said, "Oh, perfect. I'm going to find out where is his dad." So he looked in the crowds. Nobody put their hand up. Nobody said, "Yes, son." He said, "Oh, it's definitely not here." So he turns to the Lord Jesus and sees him looking up to heaven and saying, Father. He said, whoa, looks like this man is the real deal. Looks like this man is he who claims to be. He is the Son of God, and God is his dad. Because when he called daddy, he looked up in heaven. So daddy must be in heaven, and the only one who art in heaven is God. So he is the Son of God. I need to redeem the time because the days are evil, and the only way I will redeem all the time I've lost in lust, in sin, in doing everything evil under the sun, the only way I will redeem this time is when I cling onto this Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Looks like he has come from heaven, and his dad is God who art in heaven. When he looked at Jesus saying, Daddy, straight away he believed. When he believed, what did we say faith is? Eternal life. Time, temporal life. When he believed that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, what happened? When you have faith in the Lord, something will enter your life called fear of the Lord. Number two, he had the fear of the Lord. How do we know he had the fear of the Lord? By turning to his friend. Because the other guy was actually telling Jesus off. The other person was ridiculing the Lord Jesus. They are friends. For God knows how many years. So this man who believed in the Lord, had the fear of the Lord, he turned to his friend, he said, don't you fear God? Have you no fear of God? Excuse me? Look who's talking. The one who killed people is talking about fearing God. Where were you, my dear friend, when you slashed someone's throat? Didn't you have the fear of the Lord then? No. Where were you when you stole things, when you destroyed things? You're talking about fearing God? He says, yes, because I believe Jesus Christ is the only way. Fearing the Lord means loving the Lord. I began to love the Lord Jesus. Now, since I began to love the Lord, I will tell my friend, have you no fear of God? How dare you talk to this holy man in such inappropriate way? How dare you? Wow, what a great man is. Before he was the same as his friend. My dear people, Jesus Christ changes people. Jesus Christ changes your way of thinking, your way of talking, your way of walking, your way of everything. He changes it. All you need to do is turn to the crucified Messiah, and he will change you. All the foul language, he will turn it into praises. All the dark alleys will turn him into the light. Jesus is known to change. A Christian that has the fear of the Lord seeks forgiveness. A Christian that has the fear of the Lord seeks forgiveness. You will never ask the Lord to forgive you until you have the fear of the Lord in your heart. Because if you do not love him, you will never ask him to forgive you. And you wouldn't even care about asking him to forgive you. It is that love, that fear of the Lord. What is fear of the Lord? You see, it's not afraid of the Lord. I'm not afraid of him. I fear him. You see, afraid is, if I do something wrong, I'm afraid because he will chop my head and he'll throw me in hell. But fear of the Lord, I do not want to do anything wrong. I am afraid of breaking his heart. He is too much love, not worthy to be broken. I fear hurting him. I don't want to make him sad. I don't want to upset him. I don't want to make him cry. I don't want to break his heart because he is love, and I love him because he loved me from the very beginning. I will try to do everything possible through his grace not to break him or hurt him in any way. This is the fear of the Lord, i.e., I love the Lord Jesus. See, when you love the Lord Jesus, you will always seek his forgiveness. Lord, I'm sorry. I am so sorry. I did this and I said this. I didn't want to. It is my human weakness. Please forgive me, Lord. You know that I love you. Like Simon Peter, he said, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? You see, do you love me? Do you fear me? Do you have the fear of the Lord in your heart? He said, Lord, you know that I love you. You know everything, Lord. I will always put you number one. And then me. You know that I love you, Lord. But I'm weak. When we fall into the wrong place, when we do the wrong thing, all we need to do, turn to the crucified Messiah. Don't run away, run to him. Don't run away from him. Run to him, my beloved, and say, Lord, I'm sorry, forgive me. You know that I love you, but I'm weak, living in this weak flesh. I get tempted, I fall, I slip, I slide, I walk away. Please forgive me, Daddy. And he will. And he will. When you have the fear of the Lord, the love of Christ in your heart, you will seek his forgiveness. And when you seek his forgiveness, then what do? You confess that you're guilty. The confession of guilt. Number three. When we come and confess to the Lord Jesus that we've done this wrong, and we've said this wrong, and we shouldn't have, and we are sorry for what we've done, the Lord is faithful that he will forgive us our sins. He is faithful. And that's another topic. He's faithful. And number four, when you confess that Christ is perfect and you're not. When we confess the perfection of Christ and we are absolutely imperfect humans, you are the perfect one, Lord. When did this thief say or acknowledge or confess Christ's perfection? When he said to his friend, don't you have the fear of the Lord, of God? Don't you fear God? He said, but this, referring to Jesus, he said, but this, he has done nothing out of place. But this, everything he said, everything he's done is absolutely perfect. He said things in the perfect timing, and he did things in the perfect timing. This is the perfect one. We are worthy of this. Being crucified and sentenced to death, we deserve it because everything that we've done on earth was evil. But this, he's done nothing that is worthy of the cross. He's done nothing that is worthy of the cross. But this, again, in the Arabic language, it's called the demonstrative noun. Ism al-ishara. Demonstrative noun. But this, the only way you can say it is when you look at the person you mean. But this. Now, this guy is nailed on the cross. His hands, his feet are nailed. He can't move, neither his legs nor his hands. The only thing he can move is his head. So when he said, but this, he turned his face to the Lord Jesus and he faced him. The moment he turned his face to the Lord and said, but this, the prophecy of Isaiah in Isaiah 45:22 was fulfilled. What does Isaiah 45:22 say? Look to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. Oh my goodness. What? Look to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. When this thief looked at Jesus Christ, by turning to the Lord, he was saved. For God promised in Isaiah 45:22, whoever looks to me will be saved, for I am God and there is no other. So if anyone to come and say, this Jesus that was nailed on the cross is not God, then explain to me Isaiah 45:22. He didn't say, look to me, for my dad is God. No, he said, for I am God, and there is no other. And there is no other. By looking at the Lord. Is that all it takes? Yes. Can you be saved easily? 100% yes. For as long as you live in the flesh, don't wait afterwards and start elaborating. Please don't. You haven't been to the other side. Why waste your time, precious time, talking about something you've never seen on the other side? You want to be saved the best way, the easiest way? While in the flesh, my dear friend. Don't wait. While in the flesh. It's very easy. All you need to do is turn to the crucified Jesus and say, Lord, remember me in your second coming. What did the Lord Jesus say to this poor man? Truly I say to you, today you are with me in paradise. Not in my second coming, my dear friend. If you were going to wait for my second coming, oh, it's been 2022 years and counting. Today you will be with me in paradise. When the Lord Jesus said to this man, today you will be with me in paradise, every single second, minute, hour, day, week, month, year, this man lost in sin, in evilness, every single moment was redeemed by the Lord Jesus through the faith of this man in Christ. Was redeemed. Nothing is lost. How many years have you lost in this world? Let Jesus redeem it for you. Give your life to the Lord Jesus and he will make sure nothing is gone in vain. Nothing. So don't cry about the time that is gone by in absolute vanity. Focus on Christ and turn to him and look at the crucified. For the crucified Messiah is my glory. I boast in no one but Jesus Christ being crucified. This is the glory of me, Christ crucified. Because St. Paul says also in his epistle to the Romans 14:8, for if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's, we belong to him. So it's beside the point whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Make sure you make sure that happens in your life. And how do you make sure that you belong to the Lord? Give Him everything. Give Him your life. Surrender everything to Jesus Christ and say, Lord, You take over. You look after me, my family, my loved ones, the entire people that are in my life whom You have given me and showed me. I surrender everything in Your capable hands. I surrender everything. And then stop worrying. Stop pulling your hair out and say, my sister is not talking to me. My brother is not calling me. My wife has given me hell. My husband is not listening to me. No, the moment you give everything to the Lord, give it and walk in confidence that Christ has taken it on board and now He is the responsible one for you and for everyone whom you have entrusted Him with. Leave it to Him. Leave it to Him. Leave it to Him, my beloved. Verse 70, therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Wow. Therefore, do not be unwise. Unwise, fools. In other words, ignorance. Do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Unwise or fools. The word fools is mentioned in the New Testament 3 times. Foolish, fools is mentioned 3 times in the New Testament. Very quickly. Number one, in Luke 12:20, the rich man. This rich man sat one night and he said, my fields have given me, you know, produce plentifully. There's plenty of it. So what do I do? Oh, I'm gonna bring down some of these barns, I'm gonna extend them, and I'll build more new barns, and then I'll fill them with all the produce the land has given me. And then I'll say to myself, self, enjoy. You've got plenty of wealth that will last you for many, 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 many years to come. Enjoy it. God came to him that night and he said, you fool, your life will be taken away from you this very night. All this, what for? Yes, the land gave you plenty of produce, correct. Yes, this produce will last you for many, many, many years to come, correct. But my dear friend, are you gonna live these many, many years? No guarantee, you fool. No guarantee. What are you planning? What are you doing? Wake up. Wake up. Please wake up. Second time, Luke 24:13. Those two friends were walking to Emmaus. 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 That's the proper pronunciation, Emmaus. Those two friends that were walking, one of them happened to be, tradition say that it was Saint Luke. The one that's whose name was not mentioned is Saint Luke. They were walking, and then the Lord Jesus was walking behind them and got to them. And he saw them talking and troubled, and you know, they were in a lot of turmoil. He said, what's going on? They said to him, oh, it looks like you're a stranger. You have no idea what happened in the last few days in Jerusalem. He said, what? He said, oh, this Jesus Christ of Nazareth, this holy man of God, you know, he came and he said, I am it. I am the Messiah. I am the Savior. I'm the Redeemer. I'm God revealed in the flesh. We followed him for 3 years and a bit. And now they just crucified him and they put him in the tomb. And it looks like it's a hoax. We were lied to. He was a great manipulator and a deceiver. And now we're confused, we're lost, we're destroyed. So we said, let's go back to our town. This is enough embarrassment already. We've had enough of this nonsense. Even some of the women who accompanied us, they went to the tomb and they came back and they said, they saw angels and the angels said to them, why are you seeking the living among the dead? He is alive, he's risen. But we didn't believe. So the Lord said, you foolish ones, foolish, unwise. I just told you, you fools, a few days ago, I'll be handed over to authorities, I'll be crucified, I will be put in the tomb, I'll rise on the third day and I will see you again. How could you forget so quickly and so easily? Fools. Third one, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians 15, 36. St. Paul says, you fool. In 37 he says, look at this, I'll read it. 1 Corinthians 15, 36. Foolish one, what you sow is not made alive unless it dies. Verse 37. And what you sow, you do not sow that body that shall be, but mere grain, perhaps wheat or some other grain. What is St. Paul saying? You fool, foolish one. What you sow will not live unless it dies first. If people say, I'm not going to believe in God unless I understand. See, some people, they want to believe in God when they get it in their head. Sorry, doesn't work that way. If everything is logic, and we've got a problem here. The grain of wheat, for as long as it's outside, it's dead. As long as it's outside, it's dead. Now, how do you know if this thing is dead or alive? Movement. Movement is the sign of life. When there is no movement, it's a sign of death. If someone is asleep, if I'm asleep and I'm not snoring, I'm not moving, I'm not making no sound, no noise, it's like I'm, as if I'm dead. But the moment I move, oh, he's still alive. So movement is the sign of life. When you look at the grain of wheat, there is no sign of life because there is no movement in this grain. Now, how can your intellect accept this and believe in this, that unless you bury this grain of wheat, unless you kill it, it will never live? The moment you bury it, then it becomes alive. Now that's illogical. That's crazy. What are you saying? You need to bury something for it to be alive? He said, yes, if you don't bury it, it's dead. The moment you bury it, it's alive. It's the other way around. Then why don't you believe that when we bury our loved one, now they are alive, not while they were on earth? You see, while on earth, we are that grain of wheat, we're dead. The moment we're buried, then we are truly alive. As one church father said, we are walking corpses. Time is ticking, we're all dead. We are walking dead people. Dead people walking. But the moment we are buried, we become alive, just like that grain of wheat. As long as it stays outside, it's dead. The moment you put it underground and all that soil on top of it, now it's alive. But you see, when you plant that seed and when you bury that seed, you get a much greater produce than one seed. You plant one, you get 40. But not only 40 seeds, you get a stump and you get a flower. You get a head as well. So what you planted is not what you're gonna get. What you're gonna get is much greater than what you planted initially. So he's in 1 Corinthians 15, St. Paul says, foolish one, you realize that the grain of wheat, until it's dead, then it's alive. Why can't you believe until you are buried, then you are living? Why can't you believe it? Why, when we bury someone, we mourn for them for years and years, especially Middle Eastern culture? Oh, my. Middle Eastern, it's forever. You need to learn from the Aussies. Come on, you mate. The Aussies, they buried their loved one, they'll go back. Cheers, bro. Yeah, he was a great man, but it's a great wine as well. We don't sit for years crying, dressed up in black. I will never be happy again. Don't come ever and tell me, let's go to the wedding. I'm not going to no wedding. My loved one is dead. I am dead. You're not. Wake up. If we believe in the Lord Jesus, then we are the children of the resurrection. We are the children of hope. See, Middle Eastern people were influenced by Middle Eastern cultures and religions, non-Christians. Christianity says, after the third day, the grave is empty. Christianity says, if you have Christ as Lord and Savior, then the tomb is empty. Do you cry for someone that is resurrected? Do you cry for someone that is the living Messiah? No. Do you mourn the living? No, you only mourn the dead. Then if you have Christ as your Lord and Savior, then there is no death. There is no death. In fact, the moment I am buried, then I can say I'm alive. For as long as I walk on earth, I'm dead. Why I'm dead? Because, I won't tell you. Because I'll ask you this. Oh, sorry. When do we stop sinning? When we die? Absolutely. When we stop sinning? When we die. For as long as I'm in this flesh, my eyes are opened. I can hear, I can see, I can smell, I can walk, I can touch. I am always susceptible to making mistakes. I see things, they make me fall. I hear things, they make me fall. I walk, they make me fall. I touch, they make me fall. For as long as I'm in the flesh, I am a sinner. And if anybody says that you are not a sinner, you are mistaken. For the Lord Jesus did not come to deprive you from your will. You see, the salvation of God to humanity does not mean that God took your will away from you, because the will always be with you, because love, God will never take it away from you. And for as long as there is love, there is freedom. For there is freedom, there is choices. And as long as there are choices, there is the will. God will never take away the will from you. If he takes your will, he has to take your options, your freedom, and love. You're no longer his child, you're a slave. God did not come to redeem slaves. He came to redeem us and make us sons of God. Free. The son is free. The slave is not. So therefore, my beloveds, since I have the will, I can do things my way, not God's. When do I stop sinning? When do I stop using my will? When I'm buried. When I die, then and then only I can say, I cannot sin anymore. For when you cannot sin anymore, you're living. Because what is the wage of sin? Death. The moment you stop sinning, you're living. Now it all depends whether you live in heaven or elsewhere, but you're living. You with me? Good. Now, when the Lord Jesus rose from the dead, look what he says. By the way, the Lord Jesus rose with the glorified body, spiritual, three-dimensional. You see, the way you are now, this is the way you're going to rise. But in a spiritual body. This body will have no bones, no flesh, nothing. It's a spiritual, three-dimensional. The way you rose, exactly the way you're going to rise in that glorified body. But you will have the same age of Jesus Christ and the same height of Jesus Christ. So if you came to this world for an hour and died, you will rise at the age of 33. And if you lived 969 years in the Old Testament, you will rise at the age of 33 and the height of Christ. The only difference between this glorified body and the Lord's glorified body, the wounds. Even the glorified body of Jesus Christ will have the wounds of the cross forever. So in the next life, for eternities to come, when He comes, we will see the wounds in the hands and in the feet. We will see them. As a reminder for those who will make it to the Father's house, this will be a reminder for all of us. My wounds got you here. I kept them so that you never forget why you are here. It was not what you've done, it was what I have done on the cross that got you here. That'll be a reminder for all of us. And we'll love Him forever and ever and ever. Now, when the Lord rose from the dead, there is no soul, S-O-U-L. There is the body and the spirit only. Why? Because look at the Lord Jesus, what He said after resurrection. In Luke 24:39, He says, "Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. I'm the risen one. Come, touch me. Behold my hands and my feet." Why are you just staring at me? Touch me. "Handle me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." The spirit, what? Does not have flesh and bones. He did not mention blood. The spirit does not have flesh nor bones. He didn't bring the word blood. Now, since there is no blood, there is no soul, because the soul lives in the blood. Now, the soul, one of the components that make up the soul is the subconscious mind. The subconscious mind is the hard drive of your computer, the memory where everything is stored. In the second coming, the Lord will give you the glorified body, and He will bring back your spirit and put it in this glorified body, but the soul will be wiped, because your memory will be wiped then. Because when the Lord takes you to the Father's house, which is the final frontier, you cannot carry your memory with you there. Now, in paradise now, yes, your memory is with you. That's why the saints remember. Even those in Hades remember, because the soul is still there. But in the final judgment, the Lord will wipe your memory. Imagine this. The Father enters with the Lord, the Son goes to hell. How can this Father be happy and enjoying the presence of the Lord, remembering His Son is in hell? He will wipe it. So there, you will not see and recognize that this was my mother, this was my father, this was my... You will not recognize none of that. The memory is gone. You'll only recognize one, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Everyone in the Father's house will know Jesus only. Your father standing next to you, you won't even know. It's your dad. The memory is gone. Because the Lord is fair. He says, "You suffered enough on earth. The time has come to give you comfort and joy. I'll be your joy. I'll be your comfort. There will be no more aging, no more tears, no more Centrelink payments, no more nothing. And definitely no more Elon Musk, and no more Bill Gates, and no more Anthony Fauci. None of that." I heard the good old Anthony Fauci is around the block. Is he here? Well, we should invite the man. We'll invite him on a nice dish, Pfizer, Moderna, and AstraZeneca.
I think we'll give him the visor one for the main meal, just to make, you know, the Rothschild and Bill Gates a bit happy. My goodness, childish. You know, the way humanity is acting nowadays, absolute fools. These people are fools. Now, that's not an insult. That's just stating a fact. Because a fool is the one that does not care about his eternity. He thinks he lives here forever. And he thinks that this is it, because the Big Bang made him, or made her, or in between. So when they die biologically and put in the grave, oh, they'll realize, oh, that's not it. Mother Nature didn't make me. Uh-oh. I was a fool. But too late. Do not be fools, but wise. Why? You need to redeem the time, because the days are evil. Believe you me. And then believe you me, and then believe you me. Jesus Christ is the only truth. I don't care you're a Christian, you're a Muslim, you're a Buddhist, you're a Hindu, you're an atheist. I don't care what your religion is and what your color is and your race is. And I don't care. With all love and respect, believe me, I'm saying this. Believe you me, believe you me. You die as a Muslim, you die as a Buddhist, you die as an atheist, you die as a Hindu, you die as a Christian, believe you me, you will only face one. Only there's only one God. This God, his name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. The only one. This is the truth. Nothing to do with this uniform. Nothing to do with this outfit, nothing. Christ has got nothing to do with this. Doesn't matter, I dress up in a long skirt with a tent covering my head. This is very ancient, by the way. This goes back all the way to the 3rd century. Yes, very ancient. But Christ is the true divine God. We need the Lord Jesus, my beloved. I need to finish it. So the Lord never mentioned blood. He said, I don't have, the Spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see I have. No mention of blood. The soul is gone. The memory is wiped. But look what he's saying in here. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. How do I know what the will of the Lord? How do I know? What is the will of the Lord in my life? We ask this question a lot. What is the will of the Lord in my life? How do I know what is the will of the Lord in my life? Yet this world is placed in the bosom of Satan and the days are evil. How would I know? He says, you want to know what the will of the Lord in your life is? Read verse 18. And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. How will you know what the will of the Lord in your life is when you stop being drunk by wine, but rather filled by the Holy Spirit? The day you are filled by the Holy Spirit, you will know what the will of the Lord in your life is, because the only one who can reveal to you what is the will of the Lord in your life is the Lord himself. And the only way the Lord will reveal it is through his Holy Spirit that is dwelling in you through the holy sacrament of baptism. Now, how do I make the Holy Spirit work in me? Verse 19. Quickly. Five things. Five things you do, you will see what the Lord wants from you. It's not me, it's the Holy Bible. Five things. What do? Speaking to one another in psalms. Do we speak to another in psalms? Let me tell you this very quickly. I wish I had more time. Ach is in Arabic, Assyrian. Ouch is in English, equivalent. Speak to one another in psalms. Listen, my dear friends. This brain, God put it there for it to think. It's got to do a job. He can't stop it. This is to think. If we do not preoccupy this with the word of God, Psalms, it's going to be preoccupied with the word of the world, which is placed in the bosom of Satan. If you do not get busy with Christ, you will end up being busy with Satan. Because this is it. It's either the light, Jesus Christ, or the darkness, Satan. You can never claim to be free. Please give up on this nonsense. You're not free. There is no such thing as it's freedom. There is no such thing as democracy. Please stop listening to the mainstream media. Please stop listening to the Western world speaking about United Nations, human rights. This is evil nonsense. They have enslaved the human race under the banner of human rights. I beg you, they have enslaved the human being under the banner of human rights. Because there is no freedom in the world. The world is placed in the bosom of Satan, the killer of mankind, the snake, the poisonous cobra. The Lord has revealed Satan in 2020. He made him surface up. Satan would never surface up. He's a submarine. He likes to do things in disguise, in quietness, in the depth. But the Lord forced him to surface up. He wants humanity to see. He's opening the eyes of those who are willing to listen to Christ. Those who are willing to listen to Christ, He is opening your eyes. What has been happening in recent years, it is absolute satanic. But all done in the name of human rights, democracy, United Nations. United Nations is built on something of the ancient times, the Tower of Babylon. Where I come from, baby. Hello, Habibi. United Nations is a replica of the Tower of Babel. Thousands and years ago. What is the Tower of Babel? Human rights, not God's rights. If you speak about God's rights, they will stone you to death. They will cast you out of their assembly. They will ridicule you and they will persecute you. How dare you say God disapproves of this? Look what they did to the Supreme Court in America for going against abortion. Oh, they slain this judge, poor thing. But you know what? God bless you, my dear friend. You're a man of God and you are a great judge. Well done. Put your hands together for this judge. You have your body and you do whatever you want with it. It's not your body. You little fool. And this baby in that womb is not yours to do whatever you want. Life is not yours. Simply, did you create this life? No. Since you are not the creator, then be quiet. You have no right. You have no right to do whatever with this life. Neither your life is yours, nor the baby in your womb is yours. It is of God's. He's the only one that has the right to put it or to take it. Humanity have become fools, unwise, not discerning the evil days we're living in. Not discerning. Speak to one another in psalms. We need to talk to each other in the love of Christ. We need to invite Christ in our conversations. Do not speak vanity. Please, I beg you, if you are sitting in a place, in an assembly, read Psalm 1. Psalm 1, it said, don't sit in the assembly of the wicked. They sit and talk nonsense. Oh, I went and bought this, I went and got this, I went and did this, I went and... What is this? What is this? How are you? Are you okay? Remember Jesus Christ, what he says. My dear friend, have you been to church lately? My dear sister, have you read the Bible lately? My brother, dad, mom, friend, cousin, we need to be with the Lord. Now, this is speaking to one another in Psalms. If you have a life of prayer, that is Psalms. Speak to one another in Psalms. Have a life of prayer. Also, speak to one another with what? Hymns, the life of thanksgiving. Speak to one another in spiritual songs, the life of happiness. Speak to one another in a way of singing, the life of advancement and growth. And speak to one another in making melody in your hearts for the Lord. That is the life of sanctity. If you have a life of prayer, a life of thanksgiving, a life of happiness, a life of advancement and growth, and a life of sanctity, the Holy Spirit will reveal what the will of the Lord is in your life. We're too busy with this world, and then we say, how come God is not telling me what he wants from me? Of course he won't. You are busy with Satan. Why would God tell you? You are gone and placed yourself in the bosom of Satan. Why would the Lord be interested to reveal his will in your life? Where is the fairness? Do you see, my beloved friend, if you spend your time in the club, why would Jesus tell you what he expects of you? If you spend your time in drinking and gambling and drugs, why would the Lord reveal his will to you? If you spend your time in the dark alleys and the Star City casinos and in Las Vegas and King's Cross, why would the Lord Jesus reveal his will to you? Tell me why. It's not fair. If the Lord reveals his will, then he is not fair, and far from him, he is the fair one. But come to church, read his word, sing to him, love him, thank him always, and see if the Lord is going to tell you or not. He will, for he is faithful to every promise he made. He delivers. He delivers. I don't know, lately I've been screaming. But it's not me. That's the thing. Don't ever think this piece of a wreck is screaming. No, it's the Lord. Believe you me, the moment I walk out of this door, I'm a different person. This is the Holy Spirit. This is Christ speaking to his children. He is saying, wake up, redeem the time, for the days are evil. Can't you see? What else do you want me to reveal to you to prove that this is an evil time and generation? What else? And for church leaders to come out so and say everything is fine. Everything is fine. Yes, everything is fine in the Lord. But don't tell me what's happening in the world is from God. If you say that, don't stand before me, because only God can save you from me. Only God. Don't stand. If you're saying this is from God, yes, this is a disciplinary action from God, yes, but through Satan. God
will never inject poison in no one, please. God is the source of life, not death. God is the source of light, not darkness. But he left Satan to do God's will. He knew humanity are not going to listen to him, so he left Satan as a disciplinary action in the negative way. God cannot punish you in a negative. Therefore, he left Satan to use him as a tool. So what's been happening? 100% evil. Nowadays, people are joyous for evil things. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. You cannot refer to your child as he or she. You need to say it. Well, if this child is an it, then you are an it. And since you're an it, then you are nothing to me. The next time you talk, I'll say, who is it? It is, it was. One of these days. I only talk to a human, not an it. Do you build a relationship with a rock? Do you build a relationship with a plant or with a human? The rock is it, the plant is it, the human is not it. It's not it. We're talking foolishly here. We've lost touch with the true divine God, the source of wisdom. The source of wisdom. To sum it up, at home, invite Christ. Family, mom, dad, children. When you're talking a normal conversation, bring Jesus and thank him. When you talk to each other and laugh, say, thank you, Lord, for this wonderful moment. When you put the food on the table and you eat together as one family, thank the Lord. Say, Lord, thank you for this food. Thank you for this moment that the family is sitting at the same table, eating together. When you are looking at the face of your wife, husband, son, daughter, brother, sister, thank the Lord. Regardless what is happening, what if there are frictions or not, regardless, but thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. Thank him. Thank him in every moment, good times and bad times, in sickness and in health, in richness and in poorness. Thank him always. Thank him. He will reveal his will when you thank him. And then singing to him. Don't sing to the world, sing to Christ. So many beautiful voices, yet lost, singing vanity. Hollywood. Those who went and became famous in Hollywood, where are they? Where are they? Michael Jackson started as a choir boy. Celine Dion, Whitney Houston, choir. Mariah Carey, choir. Look what fame does. Look the environment you allow yourself to be, how influential it is. Don't tell me I can handle it. Don't say I know what I'm doing.
Don't say, you know, it's safe, it's okay, I'll go with my friends, but I know what I'm going to do and what I'm going to say. No, you cannot. After a little while, they will influence you, my dear friend. And before you know it, you do exactly as they do and even more. Sing to the Lord Jesus. Praise the Lord Jesus. You know, when you sing a song that has the name of Jesus in it, the moment you invoke His holy name, you are in a different realm. You are engulfed from within. You are filled. You are enriched. You become someone else. So beautiful. All your miseries are gone. All your worries are gone. And sing melodies in your heart to the Lord. That's a life of sanctity. The heart is the secret place where the relationship between you and Christ is done in secret. There are things you don't tell everyone about it. When Jesus comes, you don't come and say, oh, Jesus said this and Jesus said that, and you run and you tell everyone. No, no, no. What you say should be just a drop in the ocean compared to what you keep in secret, because the Lord loves a life of secrecy. He loves it. It's an intimate one. It's between Him and you. The world needs not to know of. Why should they know? This is between my heavenly groom and the bride. This is an intimate one. It's a honeymoon. It's a holy, holy, holy relationship. Holy, not filthy, holy. Holy. Where the Lord comes and tells you things and it stays between Him and you. And then He tells you what's going to happen next. And you know. And even if the Pope talks, the Lord told me. Even if the Patriarch talks, but the Lord told me. Even if the whole world talks, but the Lord told me. And what matters is the Lord, not anyone else. No one comes before the Lord, no one. Psalms, hymns, psalms, life of prayer. Start praying. Life of thanksgiving, hymns. Thank Him. Even if you're in trouble, thank Him. Not only in successes, thank Him in failures. Spiritual songs, life of happiness. Be happy in the Lord. Let the Lord be your happiness, not the occasions and the moments and whatever is happening around you. Forget about what is happening around you. Let Christ be your happiness. And with singing, sing to the Lord, stop singing to the world. It's a life of advancement and growth. You will grow spiritually and you will go forward, not backward. And finally, five, making melody in your hearts, a life of sanctity. Live a life of secrecy. Keep things between you and the Lord only. No one else is to know. This is the characteristic of a wise. And this is St. Paul. It's Bishop Murray. Thank you very much for your attention. Just a couple of announcements and we'll let you go. This Sunday, according to our church calendar, is what we call the Feast of God. In Aramaic or Syriac, Nusard El. Nusard El. El in Hebrew or Aramaic, Syriac means God, El. And Nusard is the Feast of God. Back in our country, on this day, we used to sprinkle water on each other. And I don't know, maybe it's a tradition elsewhere, I don't know. But we'd go and with buckets and from the rooftop throwing water at each other. Oh, you should have seen it, was fun. And it used to be like it's in July, so in the Middle East, it's the hottest month in the year. So it was beautiful fun and sprinkling water. Now, this sprinkling of water resembles two things. Saint Thomas, one of the 12 apostles of the Lord Jesus, He ended up going to Iran, Persia, Iran, and there is a city called Urmia. Urmia is a city in Iran, and there is the Sea of Urmia. Now, the Sea of Urmia is also very salty, but not as salty as the Dead Sea. However, it's extremely salty. So when he went to from Jerusalem to Iran and to Urmia, he started preaching the gospel to the Iranian people. And in the thousands started believing in the Lord Jesus and coming into the kingdom of heaven. So St. Thomas, he looked and he said, if I baptized each one like Bishop Murray does it, I'll die and I'll finish and I won't even be baptizing 10, 20 people maximum. So he brought all those thousands of people to the Sea of Urmia and he baptized them by sprinkling water on them. And I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So there was this multitude of people being baptized at the same time. So the sprinkling of the water resembles what St. Thomas did when we read his biography. And also water resembles or symbolizes the Word of God. When you sprinkle water on someone's face, whether you like it or not, you get startled and there's a big smile on your face. If you really think about it, there's always a smile. Oh, you smile. So the Word of God was sprinkled on humanity, and those who received it, it was just like that refreshing water and with a big smile on their face. For the first time ever, I am relieved of my sins. Joy and happiness. So this Sunday, so if you come this Sunday, I will sprinkle you with water. Oh, wonderful. For the next month, the Assumption of Our Holy Mother Mary, according to our church calendar, it is on the 28th of August. Now, this is the old calendar. 15th of August is 28th of August. So 15th of August, old calendar, is the 28th of August, new calendar. So when you celebrate the Feast of the Holy Mother, new calendar, on the 15th of August, we do again as also on the 15th, but we do it the 15th of August old calendar, which is the equivalent of the 28th of August new calendar, because the difference between new and old calendar is 13 days between the Julian and the Gregorian. Gregorian is the new calendar after Saint Gregory, the Pope of Rome, and Julian calendar is the old calendar. So on the 28th of August, which is a Sunday, we are celebrating the Assumption, the Feast of the Assumption of Our Holy Mother Mary, the love of my life, my sweetheart. I can't do without my mama. I love the Lord, man, but my mama is sweet. They are a package. They come together. Jesus is never alone. Whoever tells you Jesus is alone is nonsense. Jesus has a family, and Jesus has a mother, and he adores his mother. Whether you like it or not, sooner or later you'll find out. You will know, but I pray you know while here on earth, not over there. But you will find out how much Jesus loves his mama. So he adores his mom. He adores his mom. So the Feast of the Holy Mother is on the 28th of August. On that day, we are celebrating the Holy Mass only in the morning. There will not be one in English in the evening because we will be ordaining 9 deacons on the day as well. Everyone is invited. Not invited, this is your home. You don't need to be invited. This is your home. So I would love to see you all on that Sunday, the 28th of August. In the morning, starts at 9 a.m. The Holy Mass service starts at 9 a.m. And during the Holy Mass service, we'll be ordaining 9 deacons with the Lord's grace. So because of the Feast of the Assumption, on Friday, the 26th of August, at 7 p.m., there will be a contemplative prayer night held here in 3 languages, in English, Arabic, and Assyrian. That'll be on Friday, the 26th of August. At 7 p.m., there will be a contemplative prayer night. Saturday, the 27th of August, we will be having a Bible preach and few hymns in Arabic. It'll be entirely in the Arabic language, and that'll be at 7 p.m., Saturday, the 27th of August, and then Sunday, the 28th, in the morning, 9 a.m.,
we'll celebrate the Holy Mass, the Assumption of our Holy Mother, and the ordination of the 9 deacons. I pray you come. It's going to be a glorious day and a very happy day. And for all those beautiful souls that are coming forth to receive the rank of this deaconship, may the Lord Jesus bless you, guide you, and protect you always, always for us. One last thing. The Bible course on Tuesday just gone by this week. The reason why we actually rescheduled it, we thank the Lord Jesus for one of our neighbors here. God bless their soul. They give us a very hard time. They keep on whinging and complaining and sending the wrong messages to the council. So I need to buy him a box of chocolate. Actually, I want to thank him from the bottom of my heart for being difficult. You know, difficult people can lead you to Christ much easier than the good people. it was a bit of a drama. And then the safest thing was just to calm the situation down. So that's why we had to actually postpone last Tuesday's Bible course because of our beautiful neighbor. But we thank the Lord. We spoke to the council and things are back to normal. So the Bible course will resume again in a fortnight from last Tuesday or this Tuesday gone. And thank you very much. I love you. Jesus loves you the most. And now if we can stand for the finale prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, it is in dying that we are born again to eternal life. Amen. May the Lord Jesus bless you, guide you, and protect you all the days of your life, now and forevermore. Amen. God bless. See you next time.
I'm standing here before you, knowing you are in control, resting in your heavenly glory. Let your will be done for me. Cast my burdens onto you, Lord, knowing you will take them all. I'm trusting in your blood you shed for me. I know you've called. My burdens onto you, Lord, and knowing you will take them all. trusting in your blood you shed for me. I know you've covered all my sins. I'm standing here in victory, knowing you have done it all. You're deserving of the glory. Let us praise your holy name. Lord, we shout out to the heavens, echoing your holy name. Jesus Christ, live forever. You're the word, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. All of heaven sings and prays, worshiping your holy name forever and always. I'm standing here in victory, knowing you have done it all. You're deserving of the glory. Let us praise your holy name.
Great.